It is my real pleasure to be here today and to talk to you and share some of our work that we are doing in the space of aerial robots or drones or unmanned aerial vehicles or remotely piloted aircraft systems. There are many names for that, but they're all the same, that they are basically robots that are flying and can do some things autonomously and some things with remote control. Now, what I will focus on more is how we can leverage lessons that we learn from biology, from nature, from animals that do the same functions, that can fly, that can walk, that can swim. How can we learn from them to build better robots? And this is really one of the focus areas that we do in the research space. Now, before I do that, let me just start with one video, if that works. So this one. Now, if you look at that, you see just this pure beauty of those animals, right? You just see them, they're so effortless, almost levitate through the air. And I think this is something that, when you see that, you naturally have the wish to create something like that. So if you have an engineering nature, let's say, something like this can really inspire you to build similar systems. Although it's not only about the beauty, it's also about the function. So what about this animals that can fly very well is it that we can copy to make better robots? Now, it has started with animals, in fact, and the first drones, if you want, were this kind of pigeon delivery drones that used to carry letters through the air. So the first vehicles, basically, that did that. Then it went into pigeon photography in the Second World War, having pigeons that would carry heavy cameras and move through the air to take pictures. And then, so this done does, okay, that's better. So then we went into this. Now, if you think about drones, they got a lot of media attention because of this type of applications. Now, this is the MQ-1 Predator combat drone. And what it does, it can do targeted killings. It can carry Hellfire missiles and can attack enemies in areas without endangering the soldiers. Now, this is the first thing that many people associate by hearing the word drone. And it is something where it started about 10, 15 years ago, that it was used massively, and there are some implications of that on the legal and ethical basis. And the discussion rotates around the ethics of that. So now, would this technology enable people to start a war more easily because they don't endanger their own soldiers? That's one question that is discussed. Or what are the legal implications? So, for example, the US doing drone attacks in Pakistan or Yemen. Now, is there a declared war with Yemen or Pakistan? Now, how is the international relations? How are they influenced by that? And so there are these questions that need to be discussed and that are very much in the public space. Now, at the same time, there is a completely different or parallel stream of drone technology, where drones are used for many, many different things. And this is now really exponentially growing, and many different industries are looking at this space. For example, drones are used to help in Fukushima cleanups, so to monitor the radiation levels in different areas. They're now used in Nepal also to help with monitoring the damage and rescuing people. So they are really now a key part of the search and rescue and the humanitarian aid activities. So I call this the drone evolution. And in fact, it happens not only in search and rescue, but also on the toy market. Now, you have these toys. So can I ask who here bought or gifted a drone to someone last Christmas? Maybe someone, a few, well, you're a bit shy. You can be more, it's OK. OK, about maybe 10% of the people here, 5, 10%. And it was one of the most favorite gifts, so because it's actually a lot of fun as well. Then we hear a lot about drone delivery, such as Amazon, DHL, Google Wing projects, so big companies are moving into that. Facebook is using drones to provide internet coverage in inaccessible areas. And also Yo Sushi, for example, they used the drones to deliver burgers in London, so you could have, but I think it was more like a public relation initiative on one day. Okay, so talking about drone delivery, there is also many people talk about that, and of course it's very important, and a future application. At the same time, it's very, very difficult to actually fly something like this in an urban environment like London, so it's dangerous, it's not well regulated at this moment in time. And so the first application, I believe, where this will be happening is not in big cities, but in the developing countries. For example, we are working on a project where we are applying drone delivery networks in Africa to deliver blood samples between rural hospitals. So like this, we can provide much quicker delivery than any ground-based delivery methods. So it can really make a big change in such scenarios. Now, looking at this space, it's not only about the technology, about the drones, but it is also about how they are integrated in the city. So if you think of having drone networks, drone highways, now how do the cities need to be designed? How do drone ports look like? How do the different drop-off points and so on look like to actually make this a reality? So it's not only technology, robotics, it's also civil engineering, it's also architecture, it's also chemistry, it's also biology. It's all different fields that have to come together to make something like this a reality. And it's now underway, so it's maybe 5 years away to have something like this on a commercial level, I would estimate. Now, another application is something like this. So that's SenseFly. It's a startup in Switzerland, which was very successful. And what they do is they do mapping, for example, mapping with those drones. So it can fly through an area, then take pictures, and by using its onboard sensors, it can create a 3D map of the environment. So it can create something like this, which is rather impressive. So very quickly, you have a full 3D map of the environment. And like this allows to plan highways or pipelines, and also has a big impact to many, many different industries. Now, if you think about drones, there are many different types of drones. And if you look at this smaller space, they're the fixed wings ones, the big advantage being that they're cheap and can fly easily. Then we have the helicopters, which are can carry maybe 20, 30 kilograms, some of them. And they can fly much longer, they can have combustion engines on board. And so there are companies that do that. Then there are the multi-rotor platforms and the flapping wing. Now, flapping wing is very good for maneuverability. So if you look at the bird, it's very able to be maneuverable and can move very precisely in complex terrain. So this is something that we can learn from them as well. Now, the most famous probably is the multi-rotor platform. Now, they look something like that. So they have multiple rotors, typically 4 or 6. And the big advantage is that they can hover. So they can do hovering flight, and many hobbyists and research communities, research labs work with them. So we have one here today. For you, it's our small lab pet. So it can take off. Okay. Struggling a bit, okay. Okay, very good. Now, as you see, this is a commercial toy, basically toy. It's in more like an entertainment drone. It costs about £250. You can buy it on the high street, and it's very well actually. It can take pictures, it can stream video to your iPhone, and it uses a small camera here that it then uses to stabilize itself. But as you've seen, there are quite a few challenges that are still unsolved. So even though you can buy this and you can think of many different future scenarios, there are a lot of intermediate steps that we first need to solve to make this actually usable in an industrial or real-world setting. So some of the challenges are outlined in this movie as well. So that's one of my PhD students, Thomas Creedy. He tested some of those drones in the rainforest. So we have a project where we look at ecological mapping and climate change in the forest. And as you see, some of the challenges are that if you have a tree close by, it can fly, but then if it touches the tree, it's not very good. So it would crash. So it needs some kind of protection that is sustainable. It needs a way how to stabilize, even though everything around itself is moving. And it needs some way to sense and go in different environments, avoid obstacles. So all these challenges need to be solved first. Okay. Now, other challenges are also this. So taking pictures, basically a video from the air, that's very easy, that's solved so far. But then you might have other people, like other visitors, that consider the skies to be their habitat. And here, of course, the question is, how can we work together with birds or have something that is accepted by the birds and not endangering them or putting them at risk? So it's a very important question we need to think of as well. Okay, so if you summarize, basically it's flying in complex environments, in forests, in cities, close to humans. That's not solved. So we need to develop that first to be, as a community, able to apply that fully. And also flying close to structures, so flying close to a pipeline, close to industrial facilities, not just far off to take a picture, but close to inspect and actually to monitor more precisely. And also to fly not only in air, but also in water, also on ground, move across interfaces. So these are some of the areas that need to be solved. Now, here at Imperial College, in my lab, what we focus on is four different application areas of drones. And if you think of a future city and how robotic, aerial robotic technology will be integrated in that, is that you will have several different aspects. For example, you will have drone delivery networks, so you will have formation flights of drones that will fly together to save energy and to deliver your parcels or blood samples or construction material or urgent deliveries. You will have drones for environmental monitoring, for farm field sensing, for example, or ecological sensing, to do that at very low cost and very quickly. Pollution sensing. There will be drones for water health monitoring. So in a flooding situation, they will go and detect water parameters and like this help to guide the rescue teams to react more appropriately and quickly. And there will be also drones for inspection and repair and construction. So they will go and build and repair structures on high-rise buildings, for example, like high skyscrapers. So instead of building a scaffolding to go there manually, you can send some of those robots that will then repair those structures and help in constructing and repair, for example. So in the next 20 minutes or so, I will walk you through some of those applications and some of the prototypes that we have developed that address those challenges. So the first is this. So now if you want to move on rough terrain in a real farm field, farm area or construction site or anything like that, you need to move over large obstacles. And this is very well solved in nature by grasshoppers, for example. So they can overcome huge obstacles that are much bigger than its own size. So what can we learn from them? And how can we build a robot that applies similar technologies or similar principles? So that the one we built, you see it here. So it's a small jumping robot. And the key principles that we took from the grasshoppers is, first of all, that they use an elastic element. So it's called the semilunar process. It's an elastic element in a knee joint, which they pre-charge and then release quickly to jump very high. So they pre-load this element. So it's the same principle as if you snap your fingers, so you pre-load, and then you snap with a high power snap, right? You wouldn't be able to do the same with a direct muscle actuation. So it's very much a principle that only insects, or mainly insects, use to jump. The second is the lightweight legs. So the legs are just strong enough so they don't break when they jump. So they're just about 20% stronger than their muscles, which is very much incredible. And bridges are maybe have a safety factor of about 3 or 4, as far as I know, so much more. So having this type of very lightweight design is very key for their jumping performance. And they also use an four-bar leg mechanism that allows them to change the takeoff angle and like this move over different terrains, different obstacle sizes. Now the system we built, you see it here, so it can jump in a very similar way. So it preloads their tendons, its tendons, which is basically a rotational spring around its hip joint. Then it has a four-stage gearbox, and then releases the energy very quickly to jump up very high up to about 1.4 meters, which is about 27 times its own size. So it's very, very high for its own size. There's actually a record in jumping at that time when we did that. And so the way how to do that, or how can we use this biological inspiration to build these systems, for that we formalized a way called the bio-inspired robot design paradigm, where we basically take inspiration from all these animals. We then abstract those principles and implement them using brainstorming techniques and the best of engineering knowledge that we have to a prototype that, although it uses the same principles, it does not look the same. It looks very different than the actual animal we took inspiration of. So I think that's very important, not to copy blindly because of the nature, because it does something in a certain way, but to see what is it exactly and how to copy that best in engineering and robotics. Okay, so what we did then is also to have different shells around it, so you can repeat jumps. So you could then jump upright, steer, jump again, and like this overcome an obstacle course such as this one to enter a building or move over stairs, which is something that a similar system with legs or wheels would never be able to do. So it's actually a very big obstacle for this type of robots. Okay, and then it manages. Now, something else that we see in nature is not just jumping on ground, but jumping from trees, or to jumping in combination with aerial locomotion capabilities. So we have many animals that do that. This example is a flying squirrel. I don't know if you know about flying squirrels or if you have one at home. Actually, they're pets, so they're sugar gliders. Some people have them in their living rooms. And I like them a lot, actually, also. But I mean, what they do is they jump, then they spread their skin here to then glide down and like this prolong their jump. Now, they're also gliding lizards, gliding fish, or gliding ants, and many, many different animals that have evolved this bimodal locomotion principle of jumping and gliding. Now, to explore how we can benefit, or if we can benefit from that, in robotics, we built this jump gliding robot that you see here. So it's basically a wing extended with wings, so the jumping robot that has extended wings. And like this can move over large terrain, rough terrain, like this from descend from heights, as you see here. So just the first prototype, but it shows that actually by having wings, it would be able to upright again, jump again. And like this descend from very high structures. So a normal jumping robot would just drop down, break, or not be able to jump again. And then on ground, again, it can move and like this overcome obstacles or move on ground repetitively. Okay, so now what happens if we, I mean, this scenario would be, for example, you deploy them from an airplane, they land on an urban area, they move on the top of the buildings, then jump, glide down again, move attached to the walls, attached to different other buildings, and like this sends as they descend from the airplane. So they use the potential energy to move through the environment. So that's the idea. Now, but what happens if we want to land not only on ground, but also on a wall, for example, on a building or on a facade or on a tree? So how can we solve that? And there, if you look at nature, how nature solves that, we see something like this, which is a bird of prey that can have this amazing ability to flap its wings, have its grasping feet, have a visual feedback, its beak, and using very non-steady state aerodynamics and morphing structures, it can do a deep stall maneuver to attach and perch to this position, to this arm. So it's completely incredible, but would it make sense to copy this way how it's done? So it's rather challenging to do that. So instead, we build a perching robot that uses a simple mechanical device on its tip to attach to the surface. So how this works is that it flies and then has a small trigger on its tip that then releases two needles, so two pins, that attach to the wall basically by biting or by snapping those pins into the wall. So it's very much not like a dart. So it's not a dart principle, but it's a snapping principle. So by this doing this snapping movement, it can have an impulse balance and decelerate the airplane very smoothly. So it's a very smooth landing on the wall. And like this, you can move on attached to different structures, to trees, to facades of buildings, as seen here. So it works actually on many different environments, and it's a very easy and simple way how to do that. Now, this is especially important for this type of very light structures, which is just about 4 grams, 4.5 grams. So you cannot have a lot of electronics or sensing on board. You cannot actually do a lot. You really need a mechanical, low-weight solution, and this can be one to use for something like that. So then we have this environmental monitoring, so sensing of the environment. Now, if you think now on how to make flying vehicles more effective, so if you want to do drone delivery, how can you make them very effective? So one of the big challenges there is the energy, of course. So how can you fly far or deliver something far with the energy that is on board? So the batteries are currently, they look like that, right? They make up a big part of the drone. So that's one of the big challenges as well. And to address that, we look at different natural systems to optimize the airframes to allow for more efficient flight. Now, to make the bridge, let me show you the RoboBee project, which is basically environmental sensing using flying systems as well. And so the vision here is to create a swarm of autonomous robotic bees that would live in the farm field and do artificial pollination of flowers fully autonomously as a swarm. Right. It sounds a rather challenging endeavor. But it's actually on the way. It's about for 10 years. It started at UC Berkeley. Now it's at Harvard. And it's a big initiative, about 50 people or so involved. And looking on the airframe side, so many people work on batteries and sensing. But the group where I worked in is building the robot structure. And you see it here. So it's a design currently looks like a real bee. So it's the same size as a real bee, has flapping wings, has a small piezoelectric actuator here that allows it to flap its wings individually to then steer as well. And like this, swarms of those would be able to fly together. That's the vision. Now, the way how this is fabricated, which I like a lot, so the fabrication method here is that they use different layers of carbon fiber and piezoelectrics, and the wings are out of titanium, so there's just one layer in this stack of material that are then laminated together and popped up like a pop-up book, using this pop-up book principle, then allowing this small system to be assembled very quickly and very precisely, because one of the big challenges, obviously, is how to build that, how to assemble it, how to fabricate it. So that's one method how to do this, using a pop-up book-inspired fabrication method. Now, the current design, or I think that was in 2013, is controlled hovering flight. So it actually does fly and can do this in a controlled manner. So it can actually...
Any chance we could kill the lights and see that?
Let's try. Okay. It's better? Hello? Mm-hmm. Okay, so yeah, it's so you see here, it can steer left, right, so it can fly around. So it's a really big achievement, actually, to make such a small system fly. However, one challenge, as I mentioned before, is this. So you can guess, what's the big challenge? What's the limitation here? And one of them, yeah, exactly. So that's one of them. So it's the cable that goes out here to a power supply, which is next to it, right? So at the moment, I believe they have integrated an onboard power supply in a slightly different design. So it's progressing, but it's still one of the big challenges. And so here's where I came in on building or looking at different propulsion systems that allow such small vehicles to fly effectively or for longer duration or in a different way that can be more effective. And for that, we developed these small rocket thrusters that can be integrated on those flying vehicles to then propel it and do intermittent locomotion, whereby intermittent locomotion means propulsion, gliding, so flap gliding flight, which is used a lot in nature. But here we can use the same principles of propulsion gliding flight, but not using flapping wings, but using a rocket to boost it intermittently, and like this move at a low energetic cost. So the rocket looks like that. It's a small, very small device that has three chambers, so it's a three-stage rocket, It has here a cellulose delay charge, which means that it burns off as the rocket burns through this first stage. So this burns, so it reduces the thrust temporarily and then increases it again. And like this, we can modulate the thrust profile on the thruster. So as, for example, you see in this video. So you have a thrust phase, you have a delay charge, then you again have a thrust phase. And like this, you can have a duration of, I think the longest we had is about 1 minute or 50 seconds, 1 minute. And so it's not a very long duration propulsion system, but it's something that can boost you up and create a lot of power in a very lightweight package. So the thrust it creates here is 20 millinewtons, which is about 2 grams of thrust. So it's actually quite a lot for such a small vehicle. So just to see some first tests, so we integrated it with some wing structures. So it launched it off from a starting platform, as you see here. So it starts, and then kind of, it's just the first test, wasn't very successful. So really the controllability was one issue in the beginning. Okay, so a bit later, it looked a bit better. So we integrated different platforms and auto-stable design that then allows it to have a propulsion phase and a gliding phase and like this move on as a proof of concept design of this type of technologies in the robotics micro-air vehicle space. Okay, so now it's not only about the battery or about the propulsion system. It's also about how can you fly or use as little energy as possible. So either you improve your energy system or you reduce your energy consumption. And by how do you reduce that? One way is to look at the optimized wing shapes or wing structures. Now for that, we look again into nature and we look at how butterflies can fly so effectively. So some butterflies can migrate thousands of miles and they can move from, for example, the monarch butterflies, it flies every season, or I think once per year, if I'm not mistaken, from Canada to Mexico across the United States. So using intermittent flights, it's really incredible. So what about it, or what about its wing shape, is it that we could copy to build better systems? Now, we don't look just at the monarch butterfly. We look at 300 different species, and we simulate and test. We tested all of those wing shapes to then understand what about it is it that makes it to have a high-performance wing shape structure. Now, what we see, and one of the key take-home messages from that is that there is a trade-off between the gliding ratio. So this means basically how well it can glide, so how far can it glide for a certain height loss. And here the second parameter, which is aerodynamic robustness, which is how robust it is to a wind gust, so how well can it fly in very windy conditions, for example. So what we see is that there is a trade-off between these two. So it's you either have very good gliding ratios or you have a high aerodynamic robustness. So it's very hard to have both. And one more thing that is different at this type of sizes, at the scales of the butterflies, is that the aerodynamics changes completely. So it's a low Reynolds number aerodynamic range, so it's a different aerodynamic. So you cannot just take a big airplane, scale it down, and then consider this to be the optimized design. So it's really about different laws, it's about different effects, so it's about also understanding what are those effects at this size. So that's why this type of work is important. And one thing that we see is that there are some structures in nature, such as those butterflies' wings, that are optimized for both, or optimized that are very good at both, at the gliding ratio and aerodynamic robustness. So that's a good starting point for our systems, which need to operate in similar environments as those butterflies. So what we did then is to not be satisfied with what nature gave us, so trying to take the next step and to optimize those designs. And so one way how to do that is to parameterize the wing shape using a gene code, as you see here, so that's a different length, and then using mutation or crossover principles and a genetic algorithm to optimize those structures. So here again, to some extent, nature inspired, although it's really just one algorithm. There could be any other that we might use, but we chose those because it's very good. It samples very well the parameter space. And so what you see here, so we started with the generation zero, and then simulate 18 generations, so it's 18 times 15 wings that we simulate in full 3D simulations. And like this, come up with, we see that this one is the optimized design under certain, those criteria that we gave it. So nature might be good, but we might be even better if we then also use some of our insights from technology to optimize even more. And so here you see how the fitness function increases and then stagnates. So there might be an optimum that it might just not be, nothing might be better at some point. Okay, so now we have looked at the wing shape, but it's not only about the wing shape. It might also be about something else about the wing, right? They're not flat. They're not just flat wing shapes. They actually have a very sophisticated surface structure. They have corrugation, so they're not flat. And they have scales on the wings, so very small scales, like the sharks have. In a similar way, the butterflies have scales. And if you're looking at it closely, you see that those scales are uniform in some areas, and they're longer in the back here, as you see here, so they're like flaps in the back. And in the front area, the scales are oriented even against the airflow. So as if they would impede the airflow. So it seems very counterintuitive. So why should the scales be oriented against the airflow? And so one hypothesis how this might help is that it acts like the small rough, like the dimplets or the roughness on a golf ball, that it helps to the boundary layer to transition from laminar to turbulent boundary layer, and like this reduce drag. So having a similar principle might be why, or one of the reasons how these scales can help to increase performance. So to test that, we then fabricated similar scales, as you see here, that look very similar to the actual butterfly scale, so that's fabricated. And one of the challenges is really how to pop it up that much on this very small scale. So, but it's still research that's ongoing that we are trying to test then and integrate on the platform. So this then is the robot we integrated. No, just a joke. So that's still a butterfly. That's one of the things that we might do soon. Right? Okay, so if you come back then to the BioInspire design, so we take inspiration from all those animals, and we use only some, in this case, rather high-level principle to apply to our robots. So as I mentioned here with the perching birds, so doing this type of perching is actually very challenging. So instead, we just use a mechanical solution, a smart design or a smart mechanism to solve the control challenge and have a very lightweight and simple design to do the same thing. Okay, now these are basically research areas I worked on in the past before I came to London. Now, some of the areas that we are developing now, focusing here at Imperial College, is one side construction with air vehicles and air water mobility, so water sampling with those vehicles. So let me just briefly outline some of the recent work that we have done there. So, for example, so the water health. So why would you need robots that go into the water or that are able to move in air and in water, so underwater? And so one application would be something like that. So that's a flooding situation. So it's an urban flooding kind of scenario. And one of the big challenges is bacterial contamination. So some areas, so some houses here might have sewage contamination of the water, so they need to be saved more quickly than other areas. Now, doing manually sampling those areas is very difficult. There are many obstacles in the way. Going with ground underwater vehicles is also not possible because of the obstacles. And typically, there's a shortage of staff to act in such a scenario. So here, we would greatly benefit of having vehicles that will go sample the water and bring back, and like this help to evaluate the situation. And now, how to do that? We can again turn to nature and see how many birds are able to move very successfully in both air and water. So for example, you see those gannets here, so the northern gannets that exist in Scotland, if you might have seen them. So they can fly, then they fold their wings and straighten their neck, as you see here. And then land into the water. Okay, this one didn't do it. But you see it, right? It then dives and they catch fish and like this transition back from water to air to fly back to their base. Now, we use a similar principle and we call those robots the aquatic microwave vehicles, so aquamav, which are able to do a very similar mission. So you can imagine an oil spill response scenario, as we see in this movie, where you have many of those on board of a rescue vessel. And then instead of going there manually with human, which might be toxic the environment or dangerous, we can send those type of vehicles. They would fold their wings, dive into the water, take underwater video footage, take a water sample or evaluate anything at the site, then move back, fly out of the water using a high power thruster system, open its wings and fly back to the base station. Okay, now doing that, of course, requires impact protection, so wing folding mechanism. It requires low drag diving. It requires water shedding, new propulsion systems, control across the interface, very high efficient flight in air. So it's basically all challenges or all problems you might have in aeronautics, you have, or in robotics, you have them all here. So it's basically very difficult to do that. Now, the good news, though, is that in nature, many animals have done that very well. So for example, the gannets, as we've seen, but they're also the flying fish or the guillemots or the penguins that fly, jump out of water, or the flying squid. Now, the flying squid are very interesting. So they actually move underwater with their jet propulsion like all other squids. But what they can do is they can jet with a very high power thrust and like this jump out of the water and fly in air. So they use that to escape predators or to travel at a low energetic cost. So that's a very interesting principle that we look at. Now, we have built a similar system that uses this same squid-inspired jumping principle. And as you see here, so it's basically use a water jet, like a water rocket, but a much higher power. And like this can jump out of the water and then would open its wings and fly off. So this transition from underwater to air is actually very difficult, and it's one of the, that's actually the first demonstration of having, showing this on a small robotic system like that. So that's actually in Hyde Park testing. Okay, so looking at it, to it in more detail, so we see there is a thrust phase underwater. And the good thing about this thruster is that it works as well in air, so across interfaces. And by characterizing this and modeling this transition and the thruster profile and so on, we can show that actually the flight velocity it can reach by moving through the water surface can be up to 13 meters per second, which is fast enough for sustained flight. So it can be a propulsion system that allows it to take off through the water surface and then fly back. Okay, so that's the water health aspect. Now, last topic being the construction. And so basically there again, we can look into nature of how to build or how to repair structures. Now, for example, here, the spiders. Now, they are very interesting because they are able to create very intricate structures in very undefined or undetermined environments that might also change. So you can adapt to those environments. You can create this very precise structures in this very imprecise environment, which is an incredible capability. I mean, we have all these animals around us, but seeing what they actually do or is very, very inspirational, also very amazing to see that, because we are still far of that in robotics to some extent. Okay, so another area, another animal that does something very well, which is construction in these inaccessible areas, are those swiftlets. And what they do is they use their saliva to build their nest. So they basically 3D print their nest using their saliva, like this, build their nest in their inaccessible areas. So they didn't get much credit for their 3D printing because they basically invented it. But good, so that's one of the capabilities we can leverage on. So what we did there is to look at 3D printing drones or 3D printing with flying robots. And here the idea being similar to the birds is having some saliva or 3D printing material on board of the drone. And then by flying and depositing it in air, we would be able to build up layers of materials and like this create structures. Or we would be able to repair leaks or repair a fracture in a building or in a roof, for example. So use this more as a patching mechanism to repair structures. Okay, so the current prototype looks, so one of the prototypes we have looks like that, so it can fly and then deposit this foam and like this create some kind of a layer of this material. So of course doing that is very challenging because having this very high precision flight to do something like this repetitively is actually very difficult, especially with ground effect because of the turbulence, flying close to ground, so doing that is actually very hard. So we're looking at different ways now how to improve the precision and show more like a layered process as well. So one application that is not just 3D printing or not so much 3D printing but more using it as an adhesive is if you imagine here a radioactive box or a bomb or any kind of thing you want to dispose of which might be dangerous. So one of those vehicles could come and deposit some of this adhesive on top of this vehicle, on top of this structure. Then a different drone might land on it, wait until it hardens, and then carry it away into a safe location, like this help in remedy or response to these scenarios. Another scenario might be this, to have a ground robot that might not be able to overcome rough terrain, and then have an aerial system that comes and 3D prints or basically deposits material to create some kind of bridge or flatten the environment for the ground vehicle to then move over it. So that's just one proof concept, this demonstration. Or you can just use it to paint your logos all over the place. Okay, so this summarizes some of the work we've done, so it could talk for longer, but I think it gives an overview on some of those research areas and some of the areas how, again, these robots become part of our cities. So they will be really living along with us. They already do with our toys or with the industrial sensing and inspection. But this will be much, much more. We're really just now at the beginning of this drone revolution, and this is really something that's going to happen a lot over the next years. Okay, so just to finish, a few words about Imperial College, since we are the friends of Imperial College. So how this is integrated and how the college is moving in that space. And something that happened recently is that we have created an Imperial College Robotics Forum, where all the robotics groups at the college came together, so there are actually 18 robotics groups in the college, which makes us one of the biggest centers in robotics in Europe, and there are many different aspects, and all being loosely related to cybernetics, biorobotics, medical robotics, different aspects of biology, robotics, and this interfaces along across these areas. So the college, of course, you know where it is, right? That's Hyde Park here. We're now in this building here. And so it spans across the college. So my lab is here, our lab. So we have a testing area here. We do some outdoor testing in Hyde Park. And the college recently received a larger grant, a capital equipment grant from EPSRC, which is like the National Science Foundation in the UK for engineering, on rapid prototyping equipment. So we basically are very well equipped now for creating robotic systems and so on. So that has been achieved by the Hamlin Center for Medical Robotics that is now distributing this also across different departments. So many people can use it. Actually, it's an open facility for the society to use also. We also received wind tunnels, the National Wind Tunnel Facility, which is also a big initiative that we are building also in the aeronautics department. So I'm located in the aeronautics department. So this also allows us to test and develop these aerostructures and new, more advanced drone technologies. And something that I'm very excited about is the new flight arena here that we received last year. And this was a very generous gift from Brahma Vasudevan, who's an alumnus from the college, from mechanical engineering, I think. And so he donated some for us to build a new flight lab where we can test and develop those flying robots. So this you might recognize, right? That's Dalby Court in the college. So here is this roof. So that's the faculty building. And on this roof, at the moment, there is a white hut. Now this will transition. In 2017, we will open a new facility, which is projected to look like that. So like you see here, so it will have a glass wall here. And inside of that will be an integrated research and teaching space that will look a bit like that, so it's slightly different, but it gives an idea here. And so we'll have here teaching labs, so for student projects to work along with the research, while at the same time the research happens here in this area, where we have cameras, so we have 16 high-speed cameras to track the robots in flight and develop different control algorithms. And also we'll have an air water, like a water tank to study those air water ground robots and develop in this space. So I'm very thankful for this donation, and it's a very exciting development that will allow us to do cutting-edge research in this area. So one last thing to mention is Imperial West. So as you might know, Imperial College is expanding to a new campus in West London. So this is London, this Hyde Park here. At the moment we are here, that's the South Kensington campus. But the college acquired a large area of land here next to Notting Hill, so that's Notting Hill, next to it. It is partly the old BBC White City area. And so something that is very convenient here is this, which is Wormwood Scrubs, which you might know, right? It's the only remote-controlled airplane testing area, flight area for hobbyists in the central London area. So this allows us to test and develop flying robots for outdoor applications just across the road of Imperial West, which is very convenient. So otherwise, it will be a very exciting development in Imperial West, so with a lot of opportunities to invest and to shape also this opportunity and development. So to finish off, coming back to the bio-inspired robot design, so title of the talk, and I think something that is very important in this space is the interdisciplinary curiosity. So just to have an interest, not only about the fields that we are educated in or working in, but also across discipline, across boundaries, because this still happens a lot. So I think what we need to do as universities or as the teaching system is to create more of this exposure of different fields to the engineering curriculum to just ignite the spark in the engineers to look across disciplines and build new systems. Once we want to build them, it's very important to define the principles very explicitly and then build them with the best of engineering that we have. So not to just blindly copy those systems. And like this can allow us to build better systems, better robots, but it can also allow us to then use some of those robots to inform biology. So there is a whole field of robot-inspired biology that uses some of those structures to test hypotheses in the biology space. So there's really like a feed back and forth and a symbiosis that can happen in this between these different disciplines. Now, with that, I would like to thank most of all my team that is actually doing all this work. And I would also like to thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.